Now we are starting with amendments in customs and foreign trade policy. So we don't have much amendments in customs and foreign trade policy. So therefore, in this video itself, we are going to cover all the amendments in customs and foreign trade policy. The first one is related to taxable event under customs. So look into page number 74. That is, generally, goods are taken outside India. Goods are taken outside India for exhibition purposes. When these goods are taken outside India for exhibition purposes, whether it is considered as export? No, it is not considered as export. Consequently, they will not be claiming any incentive at the time of export. Now, upon re-import, are they required to pay any customs duty? No, they are not required to pay any customs duty on re-import. It is exempted. Say this. Notification 45-2017 provides exemption from all customs duties on certain kinds of goods, that is, goods exported under a claim of duty drawback, under claim for refund of IGST paid on export under duty exemption schemes, and that details is given below. Concessional duty payable in case of reimportation of goods exported for repairs or exported under duty drawback. If goods are exported under a claim of duty drawback or refund of IGST, at the time of re-import, whatever is the amount of duty drawback or refund claimed at the time of export should be paid. Goods exported under a bond without payment of IGST, whatever amount not paid as IGST, that you need to pay upon re-import. Goods exported under a duty exemption scheme, that is advance authorization or EPCG, etc., whatever is the IGST that is leviable at the time of time and place of import, so that is payable. Goods exported other than those falling above are repairs. So whenever goods are exported for repairs and when it is re-imported, fair cost of the repairs, including material and labor plus freight and insurance both ways, should be taken as value, and on that customs duty is payable. Re-import of any other exported goods, duty is fully exempt. No export benefit availed, so no duty payable upon re-import. So this I have given as a summary. First, we are paying customs duty on import. Those goods are exported. Upon re-import, what is that we need to pay? If any incentive is claimed at the time of export, upon re-import, customs duty payable equals to incentive claimed. If export for repairs, then upon re-import, the customs duty payable equals to fair value of repairs, including material and labor, plus freight and insurance, both ways. And what is this circular about? CBIC has clarified that whatever is the benefit given under 45-2017, the situation where goods are exported under bond without payment of IGST, to re-import the goods which have been earlier exported either for participation in exhibition or on consignment basis, it is clarified that the said activity of sending or taking the specified goods do not constitute supply. This is under GST. Such activity is not a supply, the same cannot be considered as zero rated supply, so there is no requirement of filing LUT or bond. Therefore, IGST is not required to be paid at the time when these goods are taking outside India. Consequently, notification 45-2017 is also not applicable. So, it is clarified that such cases will fall more appropriately under residual entry 13. What is that? Duty is fully exempt as no export benefit is availed, so no duty payable upon re-import. Therefore, what is the conclusion? When goods are taken outside India for exhibition, we did not claim any incentive. When no incentive is claimed at the time of re-import, whether we need to pay any customs duty? No, we are not required to pay any customs duty. So this is the amendment, one circular related to that. Then next, we have audit related provision. So this actually not an amendment, but these details are given in the study material, which I have not discussed in the class. So I am just discussing this along with this amendments material. That is customs clearance audit. Previously we had on-site post clearance audit, that has been renamed to post clearance audit. That on-site word is removed under section 99A. The provision says that the proper officer may carry out the audit of assessment of imported goods or exported goods. So whenever goods are imported or exported, for related to these goods, whether customs duty is properly paid or not, etc., the proper officer may carry out the audit. either in his office or in the premises of the auditee in such manner as may be prescribed. And in this regard, we have customs audit regulations. Regulation 3 says that the records to be preserved by the auditee for a minimum period of 5 years, that may be in manual or electronic, and make available the records to the proper officer as and when demanded. And regulation 4 says that the selection of auditee, that is whose books needs to be audited, will be on risk parameter basis. Regulation 5, the audit can be conducted at the auditee premises, but of course a 15 days notice to be given, or at proper officer's place. Based on the findings, auditee may accept the liabilities and voluntarily discharge the liability. Who can do this audit? This audit will be done by the customs officer, but a chartered accountant, cost accountant or IT professionals may assist the customs officer. If the audit is not, like, if the auditee has not cooperated during the audit, then he will be charged with a penalty up to 50,000 rupees. Who is called as auditee? Is it only the importer and exporter? No. Not only the importer and exporter, but any other person who is directly or indirectly concerned with clearing, forwarding, stocking, that is warehouse keeper, carrying, selling or purchasing of imported goods or exported goods, even the buyers. So their books can also be audited by the customs department. And generally we have two types of audit: transaction based audit and premises based audit. Transaction based audit means with respect to one import transaction, whatever is the related documents that they will check. If they have any doubt, then they will convert into premises based audit and they will check every imports and exports. Transaction based audit is audit of transaction. Premises based audit is audit at the premises. Under a transaction based audit, the transactions are audited. It may be noted that TBA may subsequently be converted to premises based audit. And premises based audit is that wherein not only with respect to one import or export, so all the imports and exports, the entire premises can be audited by including other entities who are concerned with imports or exports. In premises based audit, customs would review the import and export over a given period. It's not just transaction, over a period, and check all relevant commercial records including financial statements and contracts. So PBA would enable the department to bridge the communication divide and usher in new era of partnership with trade. Further, board may also select any criteria or theme for audit. They can go for directly premises based audit or they can do transaction based audit. So on what basis it will be selected, the importer or exporter? Based on risk parameter basis, but that is not disclosed. What is that risk parameter basis? And who will be assisting this audit? That is, executive customs commissionerate shall also audit, shall also assist audit commissionerates in the conduct of theme based audit and premises based audit. So this is the provisions related to audit which we have in study material. So that's what I have given this, which because it was not discussed in our class. Then in foreign trade policy we have two amendments. That is, a certificate of CA, CMAR, CS is required as a documentary evidence in case of claiming benefit under SEIS. SEIS refers to Service Export from India scheme. So every exporter of service, if the conditions under that SEIS scheme under foreign trade policy are fulfilled, they can get ranging from 3% to 5% of the net foreign exchange earnings in a year as benefit in the scrip. That amount they can use for payment of customs duty on any imports, or they can use it for payment of fees under foreign trade policy, or they can sell that scrips to others, and that sale of scrips is exempted under GST. Now, this SEIS benefit, if they need to claim, that they need to get a certification, documentary evidence. See that. A service provider exporting service from India is entitled to receive benefits as notified percentage of NFE in a financial year under SEIS scheme, provided certain conditions are satisfied. One such condition is that consideration should be received in foreign exchange. However, with respect to services notified by RBI, the consideration may be in rupees to qualify for benefit under SEIS. However, a documentary evidence in form of a CA, CMA, CS which certifies that payment in rupees for services rendered as under Appendix 3 have been scrutinized, and these payment in rupees are approved under RBI guidelines as deemed to be received in foreign exchange. and this amendment is not there in ICA material. Then next, refund of drawback on basic customs duty paid on inputs for deemed exports. There are certain deemed exports, that is supply to an advance authorization holder or supply to EPCG holder or supply to EOU. These three are deemed exports even under GST. Then supply of goods to projects covered under international competitive bidding or UN or international projects like which are financed by them, or nuclear power projects, or supply of marine freight containers by 100% EOU. These are the deemed exports. There are two benefits in case of deemed exports. That is, the person who want to make deemed exports can import the goods without payment of customs duty under advance authorization, or they can pay customs duty and upon making deemed exports, they can get refund of whatever they have paid. Now, what is that refund? That refund is only with respect to brand rate basis. Previously means they need to make an application and they need to get refund, and now it has been clarified that refund they can claim on all industry rate. If there is a product which is already notified, using that all industry rate they can claim the duty drawback. So this is an amendment related to foreign trade policy. So with this, all the amendments are over. Thank you.